Hello, it's Scott Manley here. At SpaceX's facility in Boca Chica, people are working hard, very hard. I mean, they've been working over the holidays, weekends, overnight on a giant stainless steel, well, Starship. I mean, this is really kind of crazy. Normally, looking at the quality of what they're building here out of, you know, sheets, stainless steel with internal bracing, I would not think this is a flight article. I would dismiss it. I mean, the people working on it apparently there's a company on site that normally builds water towers, which is why, you know, one of the reasons why I thought it was a water tower. But, you know, Elon Musk keeps telling us, no, this really is a Starship. And of course, I'm using finger quotes for Starship because it's not going to the stars. But if you're one of those people that wants to complain about this, please show me that you're also complaining about Boeing's Starliner and at Lockheed Starfighter. Otherwise, I'll presume you're biased against Elon Musk specifically. But yeah, this thing, I don't know, it's being pitched as a Starship hopper, and well, what we see now is that it's in three sections, and they do come down and they should in theory bolt together. We can see tabs and we can see bolts. The top two sections are much more polished stainless steel and they look just to be empty, whereas the bottom section with the legs appears to have had a lot of stuff being put into it. It has vent holes, it now has rocket nozzles, and those are worth talking about on their own. It also has landing legs, which they've actually covered up with sheet steel, I believe, to make them look like fins. But the engine nozzles, that's really interesting. Now, we can't tell whether these are real Raptor engines, but there's one curious feature that's got everyone talking, and that is the shape of the engine bell has this weird kink in it. Now, that's not something that's been seen on any rocket that's been flown before, but it is a legitimate technology. So if these are just placeholder engines, why would you build this complex engine shape? Maybe they are actual engines. So the kink in the nozzle is a design, it's called an altitude compensating nozzle. If you watch my video on rocket nozzles, you'll know that to get maximum efficiency from a rocket, you want the nozzle to expand slowly enough so that when the exhaust leaves it, it matches the exterior pressure. That way it doesn't expand out and waste energy. So this means that vacuum nozzles, nozzles designed for deep space, tend to be much wider. If you look at the Falcon 9, the first stage engines, there's 9 on the first stage, but on the second stage there's a single Merlin engine with an engine bell that covers almost the entire width of the rocket. Now, the problem is if you have an engine bell that big, then if you use it at atmospheric, at, you know, sea level, as the engine exhaust comes out, it kind of it has to detach from the interior of the nozzle because the atmospheric pressure is pushing inwards. So it creeps up the side and causes the rocket exhaust to detach at some point. And it's not going to be symmetric. It's an unstable situation. So it creates these big banging forces in either direction. So you have to have two different engine sizes. The space shuttle has a weird lip on it to compensate for this. But this is what we think of as a two-stage nozzle. It's got one section which is quite narrow and then it has a big lip on the inside where the flow separates out and produces a clean exhaust. Then, at lower pressures, higher altitudes, it's imagined that the flow still has enough power or has enough pressure over the ambient to slip over this ridge and then use the full engine nozzle. So in theory, this engine works well at low altitudes, and then once it reaches a certain altitude, the flow starts to use the full nozzle and it gets higher specific impulse. Now, obviously at low altitudes, you're paying a bit of a weight penalty for this heavier nozzle, and at high altitudes, you've got this ridge which is kind of ruining your perfect flow out the outside. But it seems to be a nice compromise solution if you are, say, building a spaceship which needs to be able to land on Earth and also operate in the upper atmosphere. And we know that the Raptors on the upper stage of the Starship are supposed to do that. So, you know, this has been tested. I've seen some papers on it. I was very helpfully linked those and read them. It does show, yeah, you get, as you go through this transition, there's a, it's kind of not entirely smooth. So you've got startup, which is kind of rough, And then as you fly through this, you get these side loads which bang the thing around a bit, and then you get smooth flight after that. And then as you're coming down, the reverse happens. This may not matter on the Starship, because the Starship, of course, is going to light its engines in the upper atmosphere, and then it will relight when it's coming down, presumably by the point the atmospheric pressure has become high enough that it's only using the interior nozzle. But I imagine you could also adjust your throttle to cleanly push through these transitions as quickly as possible. So as the question as to whether this thing is going to fly, like, as I said, Elon's telling us it's going to fly. It doesn't look flight worthy, but, you know, they're building it in a tent, which I'm going to say is hardly a point against it, because Elon Musk has built lots of things in tents which became real objects. The SpaceX back in November did apply for an FCC license to operate radio equipment, RF equipment, at altitude. They talked about the tests in that. Now, the actual application is secret, but the FCC had to share some details of it, and they talk about test flights that go between up to 500 meters and then later up to 5,000 meters, that's 15,000 feet, and durations of up to 5 minutes. So, yeah, looking at this and knowing what we know about the Raptor, knowing what we know about the density of methane and liquid oxygen, well, that bottom stage should have enough tank volume to actually contain enough fuel for 5 minutes of flight with an object this size. So that is reasonable. On the other hand, we haven't seen any of these carbon fiber tanks getting shipped in. They build the carbon fiber tanks right now in Los Angeles, and it's a 9-meter tank, so they would have to ship this via barge. I don't know where they would have brought this in, so there's not one of their fancy new carbon fiber tanks in there. Maybe they're going to just, you know, weld some bulkheads in. Hey, you know, they got a water tank company on there. I just don't know. There's so many questions going on about this, and obviously looking forward to see what happens here. The other question is, why are they working so hard? That really doesn't make too much sense to me, but there's a couple of reasons. First of all, they're launching the DM-1 mission. That is the test of the crew program, the Dragon 2 capsule. That is supposed to launch in January. It was originally scheduled for about the 17th, I think, I forget, but at this point, it's been definitely delayed, because there's a lot of stuff that they cannot do without official sign-off from government, and government is, of course, shut down. They have been putting it on the launch pad and putting it vertical, so there's photos that came out yesterday of the Dragon 2 capsule with its... the trunk section is now half-coated in solar cells, which is kind of cool. Unlike other spacecraft, it's not going to fold out a solar panel in flight, it's just got the solar cells stuck to the outside. So that's being tested, that's getting put up. I don't know how much NASA is going to be able to support them on this and when they're going to be able to fly this. But at the same point, at the same time, it does seem reasonable they might get it out before the end of January. So maybe they want to have this shiny stainless steel Starship on show at least before the end of the month. The other possibility is that they haven't got investors from the government. You know, they were passed over for various government grant options recently. So maybe they're doing this to try and pitch it to investors. Also, perhaps their one public investor, Yusaku Maezawa, perhaps he has some, you know, contingencies, some milestones that have to be hit in that make his funding contingent on those. So perhaps they're pushing this together as quickly as possible to get something flying. As it stands, you know, I don't know why you would make it from stainless steel, because if your plan is, you know, stainless steel for re-entry testing, then this isn't going to be flying fast enough for this. I'm not even sure. It's just going to be flying like the Grasshopper did. It's just going to be a whole lot bigger and looking like a giant Christmas tree ornament, to be honest. I don't know why you would need three Raptor engines. So, because I think somebody did the math and said, actually, the Raptor spec should be good for one, but, you know, I guess having three allows them to test more, you know, different re-entry or landing options. There's just so many questions about this thing, and so many cryptic comments from Elon and leaks from SpaceX. Yeah, I would love to know what you guys think. I'm Scott Manley. Fly safe.